Welcome to Medicine in 5 Minutes. My name is Dr. Moses Kazevu. Today we're going to be looking at immunization and vaccination. Remember that immunization and vaccination are very important key aspects of childcare and pediatric preventive care. There are two types of immunization that we could undertake. We could have active immunization, where we're going to be injecting a component of the etiological organism. This could be a live attenuated vaccine or a killed vaccine or an inactivated vaccine. Or it could be passive immunization, where we're going to be injecting antibodies into this individual, for example, with varicella zoster globulins. So with active immunization, there are two types. We could inject them with live attenuated vaccines. These obviously confer a long-term type of immunity. So we have vaccines such as an oral polio vaccine, a varicella vaccine, a measles, rubella, as well as previously, we used to give mumps. Then, of course, these are going to be carrying the risk of vaccine-associated disease. And then with the non-live vaccines, these are going to be conferring immunity for a shorter period of time, and they require these boosters. So vaccines such as diphtheria, tetanus, acellular pertussis, hepatitis A, B, inactivated polio vaccine, as well as Haemophilus influenza type B, pneumococcal vaccine, as well as some meningococcal vaccines. Remember that these live attenuated vaccines must not be given to patients that are immunocompromised. So this could be due to HIV, it could be due to cancer, it could be due to some congenital anomalies, or even some drug-induced immunodeficiency. With the passive immunization, this is going to be involving injection of antibodies, like, for example, injecting varicella zoster globulins in an immunocompromised patient that's at risk of getting the infection. Or perhaps a child that's born to a mother that's hepatitis B positive, we may give hepatitis B immunoglobulins. The different types of vaccines that are given in Zambia include BCG or Bacillus Calmette-Guérin vaccine, oral polio vaccine together with intravenous polio vaccine or inactivated polio vaccine, pneumococcal vaccines, diphtheria, pertussis, tetanus, hepatitis B, Haemophilus influenza B. You refer to this as DPT hip herb. You also want to give measles and rubella, as well as rota vaccine. So with the BCG, the rationale behind this is that BCG is pretty much going to be protecting against the severe forms of TB, for example, TB meningitis. And the times that we give this vaccine include at birth, as well as between 13 days or 14 days after birth. And if there is no scar, you could actually repeat this 12 weeks. That's about 3 months, unless if this person is symptomatic and has HIV. And this is usually given intradermally, usually on the left upper arm. And we do not give this to immunosuppressed people or individuals with active disease. Of course, if you have TB, then the vaccine becomes useless. Then with OPV and IPV, OPV is also known as a Sabin. And then the IPV, or the inactivated vaccine, is also known as the Salk. Advantages of the OPV is that this is going to be inducing both host immunity as well as secondary immunity, because you're swallowing it and it's going to activate the immunity in the gut, and it's going to be passed on in the stool. And the fact that it's passed on in the stool, it may actually be passed on to individuals that are not vaccinated against polio and cause what is known as vaccine-associated polio in the unimmunized contacts in the house that are dealing with the baby. Now, with non-live or the inactivated vaccine, this is usually given subcutaneously or intramuscularly. This has an advantage because it doesn't have any vaccine-associated polio disease. But of course, we have tweaked this a little bit when we've introduced the IPV in one of the doses when we're giving these vaccines. So how we give the vaccines at birth and within the first 13 days, we give what is known as OPV0. Sometimes it's not really given. Then at 6 weeks, which is where most of these vaccines start off to be given, the only two vaccines that you need to remember that are given at birth is BCG and OPV0. Then BCG is given once, then OPV is given 3 times, or so you're going to start off with OPV0 and then OPV1 at 6 weeks, and then you have 4-week intervals in between. So from 6 weeks, you add another 4 weeks. So you're going to be at 10 weeks, you give OPV2. Then at 14 weeks, you give OPV3 together with IPV. And then, of course, you give OPV4 at 9 months if you haven't given OPV0. So the reason why we have now introduced IPV in place of OPV, remember that OPV, the vaccine, protected you against the 3 types of polio, type 1, type 2, and type 3. And what we realized that type 2 was actually responsible for vaccine-associated disease. So we kind of like removed it from the OPV vaccine and we made it into a bivalent vaccine, which only had type 1 and type 3. But because we didn't want to reduce its efficacy, that's how we introduced an inactivated polio vaccine that protects you against type 2. And in this this case, we actually increase the immunity towards the three different types of polio and also reduce the chances of developing vaccine-associated disease. With the pneumococcal vaccine, remember, this is going to be protecting you against pneumococcus or streptococcus pneumoniae, and this is the most common cause of acute otitis media as well as invasive bacterial infection in children, especially those that are younger than the age of 3. There are two types of vaccines that could be given. You could give a pneumovax, which consists of these polysaccharide capsular antigens from about 23 pneumococcal serotypes. So this gives you a wider range of protection. Or you can give the Prevnar, which is going to be composed of 7 pneumococcal serotypes. Now, the timings that were given, remember I told you that the hallmark, or rather the place where you start, is at 6 weeks. So you want to start at 6 weeks and give PCV1. Then you have 4 week intervals in between. So the next interval is going to be at 10 weeks. You give a PCV2. Then at 14 weeks, you give PCV3. And remember that the preferred site for infants and young children is usually intramuscular in the vastus lateralis muscle in the anterior lateral thigh. And the preferred injection site in older children or even in adults is the deltoid muscle. Then we can also give DPT hip herb. The rationale for us giving this vaccine is because diphtheria, pertussis, and tetanus cause serious disease worldwide, especially in infants. Hepatitis B actually infects over 300 million people worldwide. Haemophilus influenza type B, before the onset of antibiotics, was a very big cause of meningitis, epiglottitis, and sepsis. And before we actually instituted vaccination in the year 1985, then these were causing so many cases. And this vaccine is inactivated, so it's injected. And usually the site of injection in infants and younger children is the intramuscular route in the vastus lateralis muscle in the anterolateral thigh area, as well as the preferred injection site in older children and in adults is the deltoid muscle. The timings that we give 6 weeks for the first dose and then 10 weeks for the second dose and 14 weeks. So it's pretty much like the pneumococcal vaccine. Now with the measles and rubella, this is given against two diseases. It's supposed to be two because we no longer give against mumps. So measles is a really severe type of illness that could complicate into pneumonia and has a significant associated mortality. There is also rubella, which could cause this mild viral symptoms. Oh my God, that is going to be causing some disease in children as well as in pregnant women. Now, this type of vaccine that we give is a live attenuated vaccine. So we give it at 9 months or soon after if... unless if the child is symptomatic with HIV, then we do not give the vaccine. And then you give it at 9 months and at 18 months, so only two doses. Then rotavirus, the rationale behind this is we want to protect against viral diarrheal diseases, especially rotavirus. So the timings of this virus is that we're going to be giving it at 6 weeks and 4 weeks after, so they are only two doses. So here's an image of the vaccination schedule. Please take some time. You could pause the video at this moment and have a look at it and familiarize yourself with it and how to fill in this vaccination schedule and when and where to give these vaccines in children. Now, some side effects of immunization. Most vaccines have this mild to moderate side effect, usually within the first 24 hours. So there may be some local inflammation as well as some low-grade fever. And because measles, rubella, as well as varicella vaccines are live attenuated vaccines, sometimes they may cause fever or rash, usually about 1 to 2 weeks after the immunization. So this time is known as the incubation period for the usual vaccines or the usual viruses. And you may sometimes get some serious side effects such as vaccine-associated disease with polio, but this is now reduced because of us using both OPV and IPV. Some contraindications that may be used in... that may prevent someone from getting vaccinated is if they have anaphylaxis or they have some hypersensitivity to the vaccine or components that are found in the vaccine. Sometimes with encephalopathy that is occurring within 7 days of giving diphtheria, tetanus, as well as a cellular pertussis vaccine. Sometimes in children that have progressive neurological disorders, such as uncontrolled epilepsy, you should avoid giving them this diphtheria, tetanus, and a cellular pertussis until the neurological state has stabilized. As well as immunodeficient patients, please do not give them the live attenuated vaccine such as OPV, measles, and varicella. So thank you for listening to this Medicine in 5 Minutes on immunization and vaccination. Please go get your vaccine if you haven't been vaccinated. Stay safe. Until next time, bye-bye.